on, man? How you doing?
Hey, how you doing?
I'm good. Doing great, man. I'm honored to have you on the show. I really appreciate you doing this.
It's a pleasure.
Yeah, man. I mean, I found out about you back when you released Star People Nation, and I became a big fan. There's a lot of really heavy stuff in your discography, but there's something about these two first singles you've got out that's really got me excited to hear this new album. And I wanted to start off by asking you kind of like a throwback question to an interview I saw of yours from back when you were promoting Escape Velocity. You said in an interview that you feel like for artists, it's kind of their job to either help people cope with current events in a way that distracts them or in a way that kind of helps them understand what's going on. Do you feel like this album falls in either of those categories more than the other, or is kind of a mixture of both?
I think the music I've written now and created now helps people understand more. The music I wrote for this new album, Black to Life, A Future Past, is really music that is written about my own rebirth and my own journey, through all the time off that we had, and really embracing myself and learning who I am and empowering myself. So it's meant to help, it's meant to feel empowering when you listen to it.
Okay, so do you feel like you're at a new place in your career where you can kind of delve into a more personal place? I mean, like, going into the process of making the album, do you just feel like you have more freedom to communicate the message you want than you had on your past albums?
Well, I had the time to sit and let the message come to me instead of me chasing the message.
Okay.
So I think that's what made it a little more profound, a little more powerful, the fact that, it came to me. I wasn't like, I wasn't on a deadline for a new album.
Okay.
I've always been in the past.
Yeah.
I did this album with no deal, with no nothing. I made the album first.
Were all your past albums in conjunction with a record label or a deal, as you would say?
Well, they've all been made independently, but they all, were within a timeline where it was like, okay, if I want to tour again and keep, it's time for another album cycle, so we do things in cycles.
Yeah, okay.
This album wasn't made with any of those. It wasn't made with any of that in mind.
Okay. The two singles you have out already sound amazing, and I'm excited to hear the rest. And one thing I love this cover art that you've got. I believe the artist's name is Tokyo Aoyama.
Yes.
And he did a beautiful job on the cover art. It kind of reminds me of like Miles Davis Bitches Brew cover, and just the beauty of it, and just how powerful of a picture it paints. And I think for a lot of albums, as much as the music is really what's speaking, the cover can really set the tone for it. Do you have like a particular album that is your favorite cover, or how an album where the art really is associated with how you feel about it?
I do love the Bitches Brew album. I love the contrast of it. It's really a above and below yin and yang cover. I wanted this cover, both the front and back, to tell the story of the album, which a lot of the symbology, the sacred geometry, talks about rebirth, the cocoon to the butterfly, the skulls, the scarab. It talks about healing, so it has the wings of Isis on it, and it represents the serpent power, the third eye opening, which is why there's a serpent head over my pineal gland, the disc of Atun or Ra, which is enlightenment, which is the crown I'm wearing, and it also represents the hawks of Horus, which is Heru, which is the original Jesus hero journey archetype. So, and that's what it was for me, my own rebirth and my own hero journey is what the album was about. So all of that's in the symbology, and even the way all of the guests are depicted as sages, teachers, wizards, sorceresses, empresses. I mean, to me, it just paints a whole, it kind of just visually shows you what the album sounds like.
Yeah.
It's like an Earth, Wind, and Fire cover.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah, like I said, it really paints an epic picture, and it makes me even that much more excited to hear more. Are these all the things you were telling Tokyo Ayama before he did the painting, or did he come to you first with art and then you kind
of... I mean, Tokyo, I told him a little bit. I told him the style of sacred geometry I wanted him to use, and from what culture and what period, and the rest, he knew as much as I did about these things. So for him, it was really, you know, he was really inspired by the music. He heard the music. I explained to him what the album was about, and I explained to him I wanted to use the old world geometry from Kemet and Upper Kush, etc. And he already knew all that symbology. So when he sent it to me, I understood what it meant, and we were just in sync.
Okay. Yeah, that's, you know, I recognize some of the symbols that you brought up just by name, but I can't say I know much about the history. What like location and time period would you associate those most strongly with?
Well, history would debate the true time period. They would classify it as 3,000 to 5,000 years old, but my research puts it more at, you know, 50,000 to 60,000 years old, 100,000 years old, and that would be the cultures of what is called Kemet, Upper Kemet and Lower Kemet, which eventually became the Kush and the Kushites, which were the ancestors of, you know, what is now today West Africa.
Okay, yeah, I mean,
so
I feel like...
it's not West African, but it's where it's in the region of what people call Egypt.
Okay, I feel like we could delve so much further into this.
Yeah, we should leave that to the historians and the art majors.
Yeah, it's, has this been a long time interest of yours? Like, when did you start learning about that history?
I've learned about that history, you know, ever since I wanted to get to the origins of religion and spirituality. They all trace back to that. There's no new science in the world. There's no new religion. You know, it just goes back to the origins of civilization and the origins of man.
Would you say it plays a big role in your music specifically, or more just general in your life?
It plays a big role in my life, which affects my music.
Yeah. Okay. Well, yeah, like I said.
To me, I'd rather go to the source. I want to go to the source. I don't want your version. I want the original version so I can interpret my own.
Yeah. Well, yeah, like I said, we could go on forever. I mean, it sounds like powerful stuff, but I guess we'll leave that for a history interview.
Why they call it sacred geometry.
Yeah.
I've traveled enough of the world to see how those origins have translated. You know, I've seen pyramids in Rome, which tells me how influenced Rome is by Africa. I've seen it in the architecture in Paris, and cities like Washington D.C., which is all support the narrative, the true narrative of the Moors being present and being the true builders of these civilizations. So it's very, it's just kind of obvious if you put together your own. If you put together two and two, you get four, I could say.
Yeah.
Put it that way.
All right. Well, I'll have to do my own homework and come with some better questions in that field if we do another interview sometime. You know, I have enough stuff I'd love to study in just within your musical body, because you've worked with, a bunch of really, really astounding names. I mean, you have a killer resume, and at, you know, at this point, you've established like an amazing solo career for yourself. I mean, every album you've had, you know, amazing guests on. How did you get Wyclef Jean for this, your most recent single that you released?
Wyclef found me.
Oh, okay.
He was working on a project with Jay Wonder. Somebody told him about my music. You know, Wyclef is he's a very active musician. He's a musician also. So I think he asked someone, you know, who should he check out? And they said, man, you should check out this dude, Theo Croker. And I believe they gave him the Escape Velocity album link or whatever. And within a few days of that, excuse me, within a few days of that, I had heard from his manager, and then I had a few days after that, I heard from him directly on a phone call, and he talked about a project he's working on and how he'd been looking for me and how he wanted to welcome me into his tribe. And that was incredible.
Yeah.
A legend like that reached out to you to be like, I've been looking for you. And it's like, me? Oh, well, here we go. I'm ready. I mean, I grew up listening to Wyclef. So,
I mean, I can't even imagine the feeling of having a legend like that just come out of the woodwork for you. I do know, I'm not going to ask you much about it because I'm sure you've been asked to death about it, but I know J. Cole sought you out for some work that you did with him. I remember I still saw an interview where you were talking about him finding you and coming to your show. Is there any more recent situations like that that haven't necessarily produced a product yet, but you've had other big names approach you that have really got you excited for things you might do in the future?
I have. I mean, I can't, to be honest, they have already produced products, but they're things I don't want to talk about yet. I want everybody to absorb it one thing at a time.
Okay, fair enough, fair enough.
I don't want to get too far ahead of the next albums and everything.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, no. Well, yeah, man, I mean, I'm really excited about listening to more of the album, but I do have questions about some of your other work, too. Like, is it true that on Star People Nation, you worked with Bob Power?
I did work with Bob Power on Star People Nation.
What was that like? Like, what did you learn from seeing him in action? Because he's someone I've always been very curious about. I'm a huge A Tribe Called Quest fan, and I've always wanted to know what part of the sound is sculpted by him.
Well, I mean, a lot of that sound was sculpted by Bob, believe it or not. A lot of it. He was really... really key in their sound. You know, what I learned from Bob was clarity and balance. And I think before that, you know, I'd always make an album that was heavy on one end and not on the other, or where I was sacrificing a lot of clarity to get, you know, to get through different sounds. Now, Star People Nation has a very unique, you know, B-level loudness sound because of clarity. So there's a lot I gave up from the original mixes and demos to understand and learn what Bob Powers does. But now understanding that, I was able to make, you know, it reflects in the latest album that it's more heavy. But I learned how to make the sound very clear and have a lot of clarity with Bob Power and make everything fit in a way that's still listenable and digestible. And now, it doesn't hurt your ears. I learned how to make the music not hurt your ears.
Now, does a lot of that information come across specifically in the mixing and mastering process, or did he have a lot to say about like less hip hop producer, but more like the classic idea of a producer, where he's kind of giving you ideas and ideas to bounce off of what you're working on while it's being recorded?
Well, he didn't track the record. He only mixed it. So when it came to him, it already had been through multiple levels of mixing. Of course, he started over, but it already been to a certain place and back. I think what I learned most about him helped me grow as a producer, because he actually showed me what he was doing while he did it. I was there for 9 or 10 days mixing with him. So, you know, he showed me what he did with EQs, with compressors, with things like that. So I was able to make that a part of what I do now. And, you know, I still send Bob Power stuff that I'm working on for him to critique, or for him to point out hurtful frequencies and things like that. So it's still an ongoing, in a way, mentorship.
Yeah, I mean, I can't imagine just even just to be a fly on the wall seeing him work, I feel like you must learn so much. So I
sat there the whole time and asked lots of questions. I mean, we have different styles, and there's different, we don't agree on everything, and there's different, you know, he has a very specific sound that he wants and wants to go for, or I would say very specific parameters that he uses. And, you know, it was interesting to see my music fit in those parameters, which wasn't necessarily what I wanted, but I did want that clarity. So I took it as an opportunity to learn what he does and what he's doing. And, you know, I certainly used all of that on this newest project that I mixed. I had another engineer mix it with me, but we mixed it together.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sorry, go on.
Rob really helped me go from watching somebody mix my shit to being able to mix my own shit and having somebody else help get it to wherever I didn't understand.
Yeah, and I have to imagine that even when you do hear him do his thing and you have notes, just seeing it done at such a high level and finding out where your difference in opinion lies to him teaches you a lot about what you like to hear. I mean, I imagine you might not have even thought of certain things that you would want different until you heard what you want different from Bob Powers' mix. I mean, you probably saw things in the mix that you wouldn't have seen before. And
Exactly. And those things, you know, those things create a type of clarity that I've always been trying to achieve. So that album, Star People Nation, is very clean. It's very clear. It's very shiny. This album, I wanted that same thing, but I wanted it to have a lot more depth than I gave the last one. But also, you know, the difference is this was, Star People Nation was done mostly digitally, mixed digitally. BLK2LIFE of Future Past was 90% analog.
Okay.
Mixing. So it was mixed on a giant board in a room, start to finish each song, and you know, a lot of analog parameters. It was kind of a hybrid thing, you know, but it was used a lot of out gear and equipment to get the sounds versus plugins.
Yeah, the way I thought about it when I was listening to the new singles, I felt like Star People Nation had like a slicker, cooler sound to it, whereas these two new singles have like a really big, epic, you know, like warmer sound to them, which
it's a movie soundtrack vibe. This is supposed to be a movie.
Is
the BLK2LIFE of Future Past? It plays from start to finish like a movie.
So would you call it a concept album?
Oh, absolutely.
Now, totally. Is there a lot we can take from just the singles, or is the picture not really gonna come together until we see the full album?
There's a lot you can take from the lyrics and the 2.5 minutes of Wycliffe. they kind of sum up the entire album in a way. But yeah, no, the concept will continue to expand as more singles come out, and especially when the full album is out. When you play it from start to finish, it's an entire concept.
Okay. And would you, and now obviously in Wyclef's verse there's some more general themes, more like socially relevant themes, but does the story of the album revolve around a lot of like personal experience of yours, or is it more about the state of the world?
No, the album revolves around the theme of you, the individual listening to it, which takes the same journey that I have taken as the trumpet player or the narrator. It takes the journey of your own, you becoming your own hero of your own story, the hero of your own enlightenment, the hero of your own existence.
Okay. Well,
so it's a very like awakening journey that pulls you through trials and tribulations, that enlightens you, and then drops you off at home as a hero.
Okay.
To yourself, which makes you a hero to your community.
Well, I love the idea of making yourself out to be the hero, and I hate to use it as a transition into talking about other heroes that you've had, because obviously you should be a hero to yourself, but I know you've had a lot of towering figures in your life that probably also fall in that category. I guess probably a good place to start in talking about that is your grandfather, Doc Cheatham. Would you say he was your first influence on the trumpet, or like how early were you hearing him and wanting to and being influenced by him, and did you want to follow a similar path to him?
I mean, naturally he's obviously one of the first and most listened to trumpet players in my household and in my own sphere. And, you know, I've seen him perform live as this old man. But, you know, when you're 9, 10, 11 years old, you don't realize a 90-year-old man playing the trumpet is a phenomenon.
Yeah.
Especially the way he played it. So it wasn't until later, especially when I really got into the trumpet, that I realized, oh, wow. It's like he's 90. This is crazy. But even just the way he, you know, his career and his sound, how unique it was, and how, you know, how very like Gabriel heavenly his sound was. But he actually wasn't my first biggest influence. My first biggest influence, who I couldn't stop listening to when I was 11, 12 years old, was Dizzy Gillespie and Roy Eldridge. Those were my two favorites as a young child. And then onward into people like Wynton Marsalis and Roy Hargrove, and then Donald Byrd and Marcus Belgrave, and then back to Doc Cheatham.
So, you said like around 11 or 12 you were getting into Dizzy. Is that about when you started playing trumpet? Or?
Yes, it is, yeah.
Okay, now, hearing Dizzy at such a young age and all the other greats you started to delve into, did that like ignite a passion early on in your trumpet playing? Because for me, I was a trombone player for years with no drive. I didn't really care about the instrument. And a few years after I started playing trombone, I started playing bass. And then I really started to connect with music later. But was it more of like a instant connection for you when you started playing trumpet?
It was instant. I loved music. I loved making sound. I used trumpet to learn any other instrument that I do know. You know, I was just connected to it. I was always into music and film music and things like that. You know, I was a kid who would take the hour-long bath and, like, sing a whole soundtrack the whole time. So what in my head was orchestrations. You know, I understand that now. I was hearing orchestrations. I was hearing the percussion section. I was hearing the woodwinds. I was hearing the strings. I was hearing the brass. You know, even though I'm just a little kid singing, that's what I was hearing in my head.
So what's
so
like?
I've always had a thing for music. I just didn't really tap into understanding until I started playing the trumpet.
Okay. So as far as film scores go, what's a movie that you really connect with that you think has like had the biggest influence on you from a film score point of view?
Oh man, there's so many. Star Wars, Indiana Jones, Malcolm X, which Terrence Blanchard did the soundtrack to. The Fifth Element by Luc Besson, Leon the Professional. That's just off the top of my head.
Yeah.
I've never thought about making a. I mean, even the original Batmans.
Okay. Yeah.
I don't know who did that. I assume Hans Zimmer, but maybe he did the newer ones. But he's great too. I mean, it's really a rich world of soundtracks out there. I mean, movies would not. They're not popping without it.
Oh, of course. I mean, it's an inseparable part of how you digest it. I feel like that can really make a movie. I mean, even an average movie with a great soundtrack, I feel like it's still very memorable in a way that it couldn't be without it. Is that something you see yourself doing eventually, getting into film scores, or have you gotten a chance to do that already?
I've gotten light chances to do it in ways, but I feel like my music is that's the next step for it, really, because that's what I'm doing. I'm writing soundtracks. Like, again, this is a soundtrack album. Had I had, you know, four times the amount of money and it wasn't COVID or a lockdown, I would have made a short film or a 45-minute film that just let the music narrate.
Now, aside from the influences that you had in movie music, was there anything early on that you wouldn't really associate with trumpet or with you know, improvised music or things that you've kind of been like more known for? Is there a influence that you had early on that's almost like a guilty pleasure or something that is very like out of your regular diet of music?
I mean, that's a good question. I wouldn't really, to be honest, I wouldn't know how to identify it.
Well, okay, here's a good
So,
example. For me, my
okay.
earliest musical memory is a compilation CD called Now That's What I Call Music, Volume 4. And I don't like that music that much now, but when I was like 5 years old, for some reason I just latched onto it. And, you know, as much as I don't identify with it as much now, it kind of had just like an inseparable influence on me early on.
Right, I got you. I mean, I can't say that I don't. I mean, I still connect to the things I heard when I was 5 years old. I remember one of my earliest memories being 3 or 4 years old and demanding that we listen to Sade. And I would call her Sadie. And I would stand up in the middle of the car and I wouldn't sit down until you did play Sade. So that's one of my earliest influences. Whereas now, sometimes I listen to that stuff, I'm like, dang, it's hella smooth jazzy. But I love it. And that was one of my earliest influences. So was, damn, I just forgot. No, I mean, so was Wyclef, like Wyclef Presents the Carnival, Volume 1. That album and those skits, I must have been like 12 years old, 11 years old. I remember hearing Mint Condition when I was a kid, and groups like Jodeci and 112, and I remember Janet Jackson. I remember Michael Jackson's History, Off the Wall, which was made before me, but I remember the History album coming out and the Dangerous album coming out. Yeah, I mean, I remember Gloria Estefan's Mi Tierra album having a huge influence on me. It really wasn't about genre ever.
Yeah, I
It was
mean.
just, genre was just used to help me buy albums in a CD store when I would go there with my allowance money every week and blow it all on CDs.
Yeah, I mean, those all sound like super cool things to be drawn to early on. You know, a lot of those, artists I didn't really find out about until I was in, like late high school, early college.
Right.
And like you said, like it's not really about the genre, but a lot of them are interconnected in a lot of ways. I mean, let's say we're talking about the current state of the music industry, and obviously hip hop is a prevailing part of the current music industry. Do you think that hip hop is a useful term beyond the description of hip hop culture, or does it kind of fall into a similar vein as the term jazz, kind of like how Nicholas Payton has digested it and talked about it as kind of a word that dilutes what's really just a bigger part of
Well,
Black
I
American
love,
music.
I love Nicholas and what he said, but he's certainly not, and he will tell you this, he's certainly not the originator of that stance. I mean, we are masters like Gary Bartz and Donald Byrd and Miles Davis
And
and
Charles
Max
Mingus,
Roach.
and
Yeah,
of
Charles
course,
Mingus,
yeah, of
Duke
course.
Ellington. We've been saying this. It's just people just, and it's always funny to me to see some jazz shit that's got Duke Ellington as their logo.
Well, yeah, I would
Where
consider
he's
him
like,
more
yo, I
like.
hated that word, and they hated being marginalized that way. And I think that the same thing has happened, not is happening, has happened to hip hop. It's been not, and this is not to say, this is excluding the hip hop artists like a Kendrick Lamar or a J. Cole, that continue to bring message in their music, but it's turned into music that's been whitewashed, and I mean, I'm in San Francisco right now, and I can walk into a coffee shop in the Mission that's just full of well-to-do tech, and mostly white people, and we just, I'll hear Biggie Smalls on the speaker while I'm getting my latte. So it's like, it's silly, it's not. Was never the purpose of that music. It's become so household. I mean, I hear hip hop in places where the people listening to it don't connect to and probably and wouldn't in public repeat half of the lyrics. You know, but yeah. I don't see those people in those communities that that music came out of enhancing it, growing it, building it, respecting it even. You know, it doesn't even benefit the communities it comes from anymore. So I think hip-hop has been strategically, jazz was the experiment, but hip-hop has been strategically removed from this community and made to serve a totally separate agenda, which is not what this interview is about.
Yeah, well, again, another big topic that we could go deep into. I mean, do you think that there's hope in the current revolution of how easy it is to be an independent artist these days, or do you think that won't begin to serve new artists until there's like a kind of redefinition of the relationship that artists have with streaming platforms and other means of putting out music?
I think it's on the government to step in and change the statutory, mechanical, and streaming royalty rates to make them profitable for the artists. Just as they would, you know, step in and make the airline industry profitable during a pandemic where nobody's flying. This is ridiculous. The amount of money you get paid for being on a streaming thing is, and the fact, and I challenge everybody out there who listens to music to subscribe to two or three of these. I mean, I pay for iTunes, I pay for Spotify, I pay for Tidal, I even pay for YouTube Premium, because when I listen to something, I want that money to go towards the artist. So if you're not paying for it and you're listening to these things for free, then it's the advertising money that's paying for it, and it's an even lower rate every time you listen to your favorite artist. I would love for people to go out and buy albums again. I mean, that's really the power of the market is on the people.
Yeah.
It's really, you know, but the Congress really needs to push forward the Music Act or the music, whatever it is that is called out there. So it's early in the morning for me.
Yeah.
But they really need to, you know, it's all these other things that get regulated and protected and the whole concept that people think that this, you know, you can spend $100,000 on a record that somebody turns on and pays 99 cents for and listens to through earbuds, which sound like Apple's earbuds sound like. So yeah, it's like we don't even respect listening to music anymore and the experience. I mean, it makes sense when you listen to some of this, what I call just, I don't even know what to call it, bitty bop, teeny bopper, I don't know, but like some of the club culture music that's really meant to be transient until the next song comes out. You know, that's not really meant to be a part of, to uplift any part of your spirit or culture. It's very low vibrational.
Yeah.
A lot of that music, I think, should be consumed that way and is consumed that way, and that's okay. But there's other music out here that I don't want to say the word tradition. I don't want to put that in the same sense. But music that heals you, music that uplifts you, music that raises your vibrations is just as important. And people don't have the same access to it. That's the way the market's set up. So I don't know. I mean, that's a whole rabbit hole you just sent me down.
Yeah. We could keep going, but I love hearing your thoughts on it. I do got to wrap it up.
So everybody's an artist now. Everybody can put out an album in a week. Everybody, you know, MacBook got everybody thinking they're a producer or a DJ or a composer or a songwriter and or a singer or a musician. And honestly, what's really happened is as a society, especially in America, we have downgraded the meaning of being an artist, the meaning of being a musician or singer or producer to be something very, very menial and minimal and attainable through technology to the highest bidder.
Hmm. Yeah,
instead of artistry.
Well, I love the idea of accessibility. I come, you know, early on as a bass player, I came from a punk rock background, and I was nothing when I started. I wasn't a good musician, and I love the idea that, you know, anyone can get involved and everyone should involve music in their life, but there's definitely a cheapness these days to the real blood, sweat, and tears that serious artists do put in their music. And I think it is important to make that distinction, and hopefully it'll be more widespread in society that people do make that distinction when they're talking about artists versus hobbyists in music.
Right, and there's nothing wrong with the hobbyists, and there's nothing wrong with the access, but it's just imbalanced. Like, you don't learn about music in school, music or music appreciation. So how can somebody have an appreciation for artists? They don't really know what that is. They listen to a rapper and think that what they're hearing is everything came out the brain of the rapper. You know, they don't understand there's a room full of producers and sometimes musicians and engineers and creators that do the most of that work and creative work. So, you know, even the whole facade of like somebody being a star, I think a lot of people that are, there's people that truly do love music and love to play an instrument that are hobbyists, and you can always tell the respect and the love they have for not only what they're doing, but, you know, people they admire and musicians they listen to. They even listen to music differently and enjoy it differently. But then you can see very clearly, to me at least, people that are in music just as a way to get famous or to get attention.
Yeah.
Or so that they can feel special. Which I think that's a serious trap.
Yeah. Well, yeah, again, I mean, I love hearing your thoughts on this, and there's so much more we could expand on it, but I mean, just so we have some time to play your singles in the show and you know, some music from my other guests' album, you know, we got to start wrapping up, but I have one thing I love to touch on with people. Theo, I'm a huge stand-up comedy nerd, and I just got to know real quick, has stand-up comedy had a major impact on you as an artist, and do you follow anyone particularly devoutly? Is there anyone that's really touched you with their art?
I mean, there has. I mean, Richard Pryor, Eddie Murphy, like, they're stand-ups. I grew up as a kid watching that stuff in my house, and that was a part of our culture. It was like rap music. It was a way of dealing with some of the heavier themes and aspects of our culture, in a safe space, through comedy. Of course, Dave Chappelle, I followed him his whole career.
Oh, yeah.
People like Michael Che, Red Fox. I mean, those are all classic people, because I can't think of any of the names of some of these younger people.
Yeah.
But I do enjoy comedy. I really secretly, you know, the way some people are like, oh, I really want to be a musician. I really do see a parallel life where I was a stand-up comedian, a very harsh one, and a very harsh social critic. And sometimes in my shows, more in a club setting, I will use the intensity of dark comedy to get a message across.
Yeah, well, I mean,
it's an art form I respect highly.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
I was gonna say, it's like you could be a hobbyist of stand-up comedy and do some open mics, but I could also see you wanting to respect it and leave it at that. You know,
I respect it, and if I were to, you know, just hypothetically, if I were to venture down the road of that, I would seek out some of the master writers,
yeah,
of stand-up, like a Paul Mooney.
Yeah,
I would, you know, who's no longer with us,
yeah.
But like, you know, I'm hip enough to look beyond, you know, who was doing the comedy and know that there's people that helped write that and orchestrate that and put that together. I would look for those people to help me get my message out correctly.
Yeah. Well,
no, I wouldn't just go get a laptop with a comedy app.
Well,
you know?
Yeah. Well, I look forward to potentially hearing some nice comedy in the context of your other work. But I'm just really excited to hear the rest of your new album. Can you do you have any other dates for your next single or the full album's release or anything else you want to tell everyone about?
Yeah, I do. I have another single with a video, and there's a video out with the Wyclef song. It's out now. It's on YouTube, my website, and all that. But I have another video and track coming out on August 27th, and that will be the final single. And then the album will drop on September 24th.
All right. Well,
where is this radio station located?
In Acre, New York. It's upstate. Kind of.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, probably like Greene County, I think it technically is.
Oh, how far is that from the city?
Probably about 2.5 hours.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I'm going in White Plains.
Oh, okay.
I'm playing Jazz Festival on September 11th, and I'm also playing at, where am I playing? LPR, the Poisson Rouge, on September 28th.
Awesome. Well, yeah, everyone should, you know. You know, I almost did a call to action. I'm not allowed to do those on the air. I'm getting better about that. But you all know where to look for Theo. Theo Croker, I appreciate you so much, man. This was a great talk, and we'll have to do it again sometime. But thank you so much.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot, man. You have a good day.